Good evening. I'm Lloyd Newell, announcer for the choir's broadcast music and the spoken word. On behalf of the Mormon Tabernacle Choir and the orchestra at Temple Square, it is my pleasure to welcome all of you to this 95th birthday tribute to our beloved president, Gordon B. Hinckley. This evening is truly a celebration of life. We acknowledge with us the first presidency of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, President Gordon B. Hinckley, President Thomas S. Monson and his wife Frances, and President James E. Faust and his wife Ruth, President Boyd K. Packer, acting president of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles and his wife Donna, other members of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles, and many other general authorities and auxiliary leaders of the church, as well as national and civic leaders. Tonight's invocation will be offered by Mac Christensen, president of the Mormon Tabernacle Choir and Orchestra at Temple Square. Following the prayer, in honor of the legacy of our pioneer forebears, the Mormon Tabernacle Choir and Orchestra at Temple Square will perform "Come, Come, Ye Saints."
Our kind and wise Father in heaven, we come before thee humbly this evening as we celebrate the life of our loving prophet, Gordon B. Hinckley. We're thankful for his life. We're thankful for a true prophet. We're thankful for his devotion, for his kindness, for his love, for his leadership. We're thankful for his energy. Now we ask a special blessing on all of those that perform this evening, that they may perform in a pleasing manner unto thee. We ask a special blessing on President Hinckley this night, that he might continue to guide, direct, and lead all of us. This we ask in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
We have applauded his television career, his stage performances, and his recordings. Hanging on the wall of his home are 38 gold records. He is well known for his starring role in Andrew Lloyd Webber's musical, Joseph in the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, singing This Is the Moment. Please welcome acclaimed artist, Donny Osmond.
This is the moment, this is the day, this is the moment when I know I'm on my way. Every endeavor I have made ever is coming into play, is here and now too. This is the moment, this is the time, when the momentum and the moment are in rhyme. Give me this momentous moment. I'll gather up my past and make some sense at last. This is the moment when all I've done, all of the dreaming, scheming and screaming become one. This is the day. Just see it shine when all I've lived for. This is the moment, this is the hour, when I can open up tomorrow like a flower, and put my hand to everything I plan to, fulfill my grand design, see all my stars align. My final test, destiny beckon, I never reckon second best. I won't look down, I must not fall. This is the moment, the sweetest moment of them all. This is the moment, forget all the odds, this day or never, I'll sit forever with the gods. When I look back, I will recall, moment for moment, this was the moment.
Thank you very much. Well, President, what an honor this is to be able to sing for you, for your family, for your loved ones, for all of your guests here. It is truly an honor. And a couple months ago, Craig and I were talking on the telephone as to what would be appropriate to sing for you tonight. I happened to play for him a song that I wrote that he thought it would be very appropriate. It kind of captures your life, and I'd like to dedicate it for you right now, or dedicate it to you. It's called One Dream. Go ahead.
There will always be a dream in the heart of each beginner, like the promise of a thousand springs hidden deep inside each seed. And in spite of what is lost, you were born to be a winner. From the moment you surrender, leaving forever one dream, one hope, one chance to see a miracle of grace unfold like wings. We hold, reaching from the heart, waiting for the spark of one dream. There will always be a place for the love between us. Many languages, but just one voice, and the wish for peace, the only choice. May the boundaries melt away, and the light of faith redeem us. For it's only when we learn to trust, we follow together. One dream, one hope, one chance to see a miracle of grace unfold like wings. We hold one dream, one hope, one chance to see a miracle of grace unfold like wings.
With one of the most engaging stories in piano performance today, the five Browns, Desiree, Deandra, Gregory, Melody, and Ryan, have burst onto the scene and overnight become an international sensation. These five siblings, all Utahns, attended the Juilliard School of Music at the same time and now are pursuing their careers as a quintet of piano virtuosos. Please welcome the five Browns as they perform Scenes from West Side Story, followed by Rimsky-Korsakov's Flight of the Bumblebee.
Thank you.
This young soprano emerged on the Brazilian music scene with their version of American Idol. She quickly became one of Brazil's most celebrated sopranos and best-selling recording stars. Please welcome Liriel Domiciano.
Querido presidente Hinckley, em nome da juventude da igreja, oferecemos nossos sinceros parabéns e profundo amor e gratidão. Our dearest President Hinckley, on behalf of the youth of the church, I offer our sincere congratulations and our deepest love and thanks. And now, I will festive song of Brazil, Tico Tico no Fubá, by Carmen Miranda.
Tico só, tico tico lá, está comendo todo, todo meu fubá. Olha o seu Nicolau, que fubá se vai, pega no meu que na bandeira sai. Não tenha medo, isto que levou, em uma cunha cheia de fubá e tu. É na igreja voando e pegando, meu fubá, meu fubá, só tô doidinho para cá. Tico tico só, tico tico lá, está comendo todo, todo meu fubá. Olha o seu Nicolau, que fubá se vai, pega no meu que na bandeira sai. Não tenha medo, isto que levou, em uma cunha cheia de fubá e tu. É na igreja voando e pegando, meu fubá, meu fubá, só tô doidinho para cá. sob a mantinha, porém que ele não lutou. O seu gostoso com balvinda levou. Deixa eu ficar quase chorando, então vi. Logo depois vou era longa e seja duiz. Quero contar baixinho na vida dos dois. Tiveram nem filhachinhos depois. Toda essa gola pela vista, toda aqui, com ela, todo meu fumaça, tão longe lá para cá.
World-renowned concertmaster and award-winning violin soloist Igor Gruppman brings unparalleled international experience to his position as conductor of the orchestra at Temple Square. His wife Vesna is equally celebrated on the international music stage. They are both graduates of the celebrated Moscow Conservatory of Music. Please welcome Igor and Vesna Gruppman as they perform Concerto for Two Violins by Vivaldi.
Thank you.
She debuted at age 7 on the Ted Mack Amateur Hour and has been singing soul at the top of the charts since that early beginning. She has to her credit several number one pop and R&B hits and 4 Grammy Awards. Her voice is heard around the world. Ladies and gentlemen, the incomparable Gladys Knight.
So much, President Hinckley, we love you. And this night we say thank you for everything you've done. And in your honor, let me add my testimony that I believe in miracles for all eternity. I believe in dreams, and I believe in children, and I certainly believe in you. I believe for every drop of rain that falls, a flower grows.
I believe that somewhere in the darkest night, a candle glows. I believe for everyone who goes astray, someone will come to show the way. I believe, I believe. I believe above the storm, the smallest prayer will still be heard. I believe that someone in the great somewhere hears every word. Every time I hear a newborn baby cry, oh, touch a leaf, oh, remind us how we used to be. I decided long ago never to walk in anyone's shadow. If I fail, if I succeed, at least I'll live as I believe. No matter what they take from me, they can't take away my dignity. Love of all, it's happening to me. I found the greatest love of all inside of me. And that's simply because believe in Christ. He is God's Son on earth to dwell. His soul did come. He healed the sick, the dead he raised. Good works were his name be praised. believe in Christ. I believe in Christ. Oh, I believe in Christ. He is my King.
One of the most unique features of this conference center is the magnificent pipe organ that follows the musical tradition established by Brigham Young nearly 150 years ago. President Hinckley commissioned this remarkable instrument, and Mormon Tabernacle Choir organist John Longhurst oversaw both its design and construction. In company with the Five Browns and the orchestra at Temple Square, John Longhurst will now perform the Maestoso and Allegro movements from Symphony No. 3 in C minor by Camille Saint-Saëns.
Thank you.
He has sung with the world's premier orchestras and conductors, performing repertoire from Bach to Wagner. A graduate of the University of Utah and University of Cincinnati College Conservatory of Music, he now serves as professor of voice at Florida State University's College of Music. Performing Funiculi Funicula, please welcome Metropolitan Opera tenor Stanford Olsen. Mike Wallace is a veteran news correspondent with the much-acclaimed CBS News program 60 Minutes. His noted interviews have included such public figures as George Bush, Ronald Reagan, Mikhail Baryshnikov, Leonard Bernstein, and Gordon B. Hinckley. The two met at a press luncheon for President Hinckley in New York City and have enjoyed a warm relationship since that time. Please welcome Mr. Mike Wallace.
Nearly a century has passed since that June morning back in 1910 when Bryant S. and Edna Bittner Hinckley welcomed their firstborn, a son, into their home. And they named him Gordon Bittner Hinckley. A boy born in the United States that year could expect to live to about age 50. But Ada was worried. She worried constantly that her frail little boy who was plagued with illness wouldn't make it nearly that long. Her worrying, as we all know, is for naught, because all too soon her skinny, freckle-faced son was getting into fistfights, pulling his share of pigtails and building forts down in a nearby hollow with his brother Sherm. In 1910, President Joseph F. Smith presided over a church of almost 400,000 members, more than half of whom lived here in Utah. Less than 1,000 missionaries were called to serve that year, and all four temples were here in Utah. During his lifetime, Gordon B. Hinckley would not only witness mind-boggling advances in technology and communication, but unprecedented church growth, growth upon which he would personally leave an indelible mark. Surely no one foresaw the influence that he was destined to have, no one except perhaps his beloved Marjorie, whom he married after returning from his mission to England. Dubbed the slave by Elder John A. Widstow of the Quorum of the Twelve, the young Gordon Hinckley worked tirelessly for 23 years at church headquarters, advancing the use of media in public relations, missionary work, and temples. And when in April of 1958, he was called as a general authority, the Deseret News reported that, quote, "His ability to conceive and carry out big, imaginative plans has made him a strong right arm to the brethren." But over time, it became clear that no inspired, innovative idea, however ambitious, was too much for Gordon B. Hinckley to consider. And as a result, he's lived by a simple maxim that the only way to get anything done is to get on your knees, get on your knees and ask for help, and then get on your feet and go to work. And he has done just exactly that, for he is and has always been a builder of families, youth, missionaries, a builder of edifices ranging from the simple to the majestic, a builder of character and faith, and through it all, a builder of people.
No religious leader in all of history has traveled abroad as is President Gordon B. Hinckley. In the past 10 years as president of the church, he's traveled more than 1,000,000 miles. We once went to Jakarta as guests of Abdurrahman Wahid, president of Indonesia. We held meetings at Tarawa, where a makeshift stand had been put together. 100 yards or so on either side, we could see the ocean. We met in Jakarta, in Singapore, in Bali, in Cairns, Australia. On the flight from Guam to Hawaii, we met such heavy headwinds that the pilots landed at Majuro Atoll in the Marshall Islands to refuel. President Hinckley paced back and forth on the tarmac, impatient, as we supposed, at the delay. That was not it at all. When he boarded again, he said with obvious disappointment, "We should have held a meeting." Wherever it is, he's been there, particularly to small, out-of-the-way places where a handful of people could hear his testimony. Every testimony spoken and every blessing pronounced by President Hinckley is an audible and visual witness that the gospel's been restored, that there are apostles and prophets upon the face of the earth, and that Jesus is the Christ, the mediator, the Son of God, the only begotten of the Father. This is the Gordon B. Hinckley that I have known for more than 40 years.
Not only has President Hinckley been supported by able counselors, but until last year, he was constantly urged onward by Marjorie. After her husband's ordination as president of the church, she said of him, "He's always been a wonderful man, but there's something special about him now. The mantle is upon him, and I try to remember that when he leaves his ties draped over the sofa, I try to remember that he isn't perfect, just almost perfect. I'm grateful to share his life with him." And that sharing took them to more than 100 countries together, all of which led Sister Hinckley to say that when you see what's happening in this church, it's thrilling to get up every morning.
This is my babushka.
Faith brings miracles. And those miracles are occurring in this church every day. I well remember back in 1960 when the work was started in the Philippines. My husband and I took 4 young elders from the Hong Kong area down into the Philippines to open the work. The thought of those 4 boys, being given the responsibility of establishing the kingdom of God in the Philippine Islands absolutely overwhelmed me. As we left the country, I looked back at them, and I said to my husband with tears in my eyes, "How can you do this? How can you leave those 4 boys here alone?" "They're not alone," he said. "The Lord is with him." He was right. The Lord was with him.
During the past 10 years, the church has grown by 3 million members in 500 states. More members now live outside the United States than inside, and more do not speak English than do. 51 million copies of the Book of Mormon have been distributed in 106 languages, including a new commercial edition published by Doubleday. And the number of operating temples has increased from 37 to 120. The past decade has been distinguished by innovation. The Perpetual Educational Fund has helped thousands of returned missionaries in developing countries to gain an education. Rick's College was renamed Brigham Young University, Idaho, and became a 4-year institution. The Orchestra at Temple Square was formed, and with the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, has performed for millions to their delight. And missionary work, as well as the church's visibility, has been boosted by unprecedented media exposure. President Hinckley's New York Times bestselling Standing for Something prescribed antidotes for everything from immorality to dishonesty for virtue-loving people everywhere. And his candor and his uncommon wit and wisdom have enabled him to even build bridges with high profile and sometimes cranky journalists.
God and Jesus spoke with your founder, Joseph Smith, back in 1820 and told him to start this church. You believe that?
Yes, sir.
He was 14 years old.
Yes, sir.
A backwoods farm boy.
Yes, sir.
In New York State.
That's the miracle of it.
Speaking for cranky journalists in general, I was unprepared for the cordial, even sunny greeting I received the first time I met Gordon B. Hinckley, and I was even more surprised when he agreed to an interview. As it turned out, nearly everything about that whole experience surprised me. I didn't expect his humor, his candor. I asked the questions that were on the minds of the skeptics, and he answered every single one. I've done stories on many organizations, including churches, but I can honestly say I have never had an experience quite like the one I had with Gordon B. Hinckley. He's also a builder of bridges of understanding. Days after 9/11, President Hinckley met with President Bush and other religious leaders at the White House. And 3 years later, the Commander-in-Chief awarded him the prestigious Presidential Medal of Freedom. All of this activity, of course, has found President Hinckley regularly on the road. When he arrived home from his mission to England back in 1935, the young Elder Hinckley declared that he was worn out, that he hoped never to travel again. Yet no general authority or church president has traveled so far to meet with so many. During the past decade alone, he's traveled more than 1,000,000 miles to 70 countries. Some audiences have been small, others have filled arenas. The pace has been tiring, but he has been tireless. But from his point of view, it's been worth it to help build the organization he loves by building the people that he loves so much.
I wobble a little, but better have this end in trouble than this end. Now and again, when I complain of some little ailment, my wife will say, "It's your age, boy."
President Hinckley enjoys pointing out that when his doctor suggested he carry a cane as a precaution, he did just that. He began carrying a cane. In spite of his protests, his vigor and his vitality are simply marvels. President Hinckley has a gift for relating to just about everyone, men and women, boys and girls. His respect for women has been evident again and again.
People wonder what we do for our women. I'll tell you what we do. We get out of their way and look with wonder at what they're accomplishing.
He just has a great belief and desire to help women and to see that they have much to offer. And he gives them space to do it. And women need some space. He believes in that. And I think of the comment that he made to Sister Hinckley when the two of them were one evening talking, the story goes, and she turned to him and said, "Thank you for giving me room to grow, wings to fly." And that's been a blessing. And I think he sees that and wants that for women, to be contributors to build the kingdom of God.
A poet once said, "Here and there, now and then, God places a giant among men." And tonight we celebrate the life of a genuinely remarkable man, a spiritual giant, a man who by any measure takes his place among the world's great contributors, a man whose obligations have required him to blaze trails through uncharted territory, a man who's devoted his entire life to building the organization and the people that he loves. We pay tribute tonight and in the future to a man whom more than 12 million people revere as a prophet. I have been fortunate enough to have the chance to learn for myself of the qualities that make Gordon B. Hinckley the extraordinary leader that he is, to learn of his compassion, his humor, his integrity. I'm proud to be able to call him my friend.
I believe and testify that it is the mission of this church to stand as an ensign to the nations and a light to the world. We have had placed upon us a great, all-encompassing mandate from which we cannot shrink nor turn aside. We accept that mandate and are determined to fulfill it. And with the help of God, we shall do it.
President Hinckley has often said that the past is behind us and that it's the future with which we must be concerned. But different from many leaders of our day, and despite the escalating challenges the world faces, he is optimistic about the future. And his confidence rests in the rising generation.
We are particularly proud of our youth. I think we've never had a stronger generation of young men and young women than we have today. For the most part, they are true to the faith of their forebears. Surrounded by forces that would pull them down and tremendous pressures to pull them away from time-tested virtues, they are going forward with constructive lives, nurturing themselves both intellectually and spiritually. We have no fears or doubts concerning the future of this work.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a great pleasure, of course, and a matter of some pride to be here for me tonight. Thank you so much for inviting me to be a part of this celebration of life and my admiration for that friend of mine who's sitting down there. And it's now my pleasure to introduce the second counselor in the first presidency of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, President James E. Faust.
I fondly remember the day I first met President Hinckley. It was 64 years ago. He impressed me so much that I still recall what he said. I don't know of any man who has come to the presidency of the church who has been so well prepared. He has been taught by many of the great leaders of our time, one-on-one. Like Solomon, he has been blessed with an understanding heart to judge thy people, that he may discern between good and bad. For who is able to judge this, thy so great a people? With this gift, he has been magnified and blessed in a miraculous way these past 66 years. In one of our first presidency meetings, following President Hinckley becoming the president of the church, I expressed the belief that part of his great prophetic mission would be to bring the church out of obscurity. This has come to pass in a remarkable way. We are all proud of the honors and recognition which President Hinckley and his accomplishments have brought to the church. President Hinckley is the greatest temple builder in the history of the world. All of our temples are impressive, but the temples in Palmyra, Nauvoo, and Winter Quarters are particularly significant because they relate in a special way to the history and sacrifice of our people. Reaching the age of 95 with all faculties intact is absolutely remarkable. As President Hinckley has arrived at this milestone birthday, he has done so with a great outpouring of love and appreciation from family, friends, and associates, and the 12 million members of the church, and a host of non-member friends. He has raised, not only for members of the church, but also for the whole world, the very essence of humanity, which is our faith in God. President Hinckley, as we honor you, we honor Marge, because you would be the first to say that without her sustaining love and support, and your superb work and accomplishments would not have been as great as they have been. I consider it a signal honor to have stood by your side for so many years and learned so much at your feet. As you move forward in your great ministry, I am confident that you will continue to be blessed. For as the psalmist has said, this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. President Hinckley, happy 95th birthday, and many more.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome President Thomas S. Monson, first counselor in the first presidency of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
Well done. I'm honored to pay tribute to President Gordon B. Hinckley, our prophet, seer, and revelator. It was my privilege to know and love President Hinckley long before either of us was called to the Council of the 12 Apostles or the First Presidency, where through the years I've sat next to him, have served with him, and have learned from him. I am a witness to his prophetic calling. He has a reverence for the history of the church and the leaders who have preceded him. He is prodigious in his work ethic and is totally dedicated to the gospel of Jesus Christ. He's a friend to one and all, and a leader who inspires spirituality. His outreach on an international scale is unprecedented. He is truly a prophet for our time. Like the Master, he's devoted his life to doing good, and God is surely with him. President Hinckley is a man of optimism. I cannot count the times I've heard him say, in essence, it can be done, and let's get at it. He does not rush to judgment, nor does he take counsel of his fears. He's a man of gifted intellect, a man of compassion, a man of capacity, a man of God. Time permits but a brief overview of Gordon B. Hinckley's presidency. In the past 10 years, we've seen a worldwide expansion of church membership. Mention has been made of the holy temples with their sacred ordinances, which are now available to our members throughout the entire world. Through the vision and foresight of our beloved president, we have this magnificent conference center in Salt Lake City. He has directed large-scale humanitarian efforts, which have relieved hunger and eased suffering. In times of crisis or disaster, he not only pledges the resources and aid of the church, but also makes certain such are delivered. We are now blessed to have the Perpetual Education Fund, which enables our young people in less developed countries to obtain an education, thereby breaking the cycle of poverty from whence they come. President Hinckley is an island of calm in a world of storm. He's as a lighthouse to the mariner who is lost. He is your friend, and he's my friend. Said American businessman and publisher Malcolm S. Forbes, Jr., President Hinckley's life is a model and an inspiration in a secular age. And for all of us who yearn for spiritual guidance, he is a genuine hero. Long years ago, I read and remembered a line which appealed to me, and which I share with you tonight. What the world needs are fewer critics and more models to follow. Such a model God has provided for our day and for our time, even President Gordon B. Hinckley. Let us follow him, for I know he follows our Heavenly Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. President Hinckley's life is a gift to the world. It is now my great pleasure to introduce our beloved prophet and exemplar, President Gordon B. Hinckley.
What an event. What a program. What a show. Mike, they don't do this well even on Broadway. There's only one thing missing on this glorious occasion, and that is the presence of my beloved companion of 67 years. I am forever indebted to her for all that she has done as we have traveled this long road together. She shares with me the honor of this night. There's only one reason I'm here. It is because the Lord wills it. He placed me here. He has helped me here. And when he chooses to do so, he will remove me. I am totally dependent upon him and wish only to do that which he would have done. Serving in this office is a very heavy and challenging responsibility. The church has grown large and complex in its operation across the world. It is not my church, it is his whose name it bears, and he directs it according to his will and purpose. It will continue to increase in stature across the entire earth. I'm deeply grateful for the significant honor you have accorded me with beautiful music and your kind and generous words. This magnificent conference center is filled to capacity, and hundreds of thousands are joined with us through television, the satellite system, and the internet. Thank you for being with us and for your kind expressions, including many which have come from far and wide. This beautiful lei I wear tonight was sent by the King of Tonga, His Royal Majesty. A magnificent bouquet just arrived from officials of Indonesia. My presence at this age reminds me of an old wooden sign hanging by one staple from a sagging barbed wire fence in Texas. It read, "Burned out by drought, drowned out by floodwaters, ed out by jackrabbits, sold out by sheriff, still here." I'm grateful to a wonderful mother and father for good genes, to good siblings, to my children and grandchildren, to my beloved associates, to my counselors, President Packer and others of the general authorities, to doctors and nurses whose pills have made me a pillar of the church. I walk with a cane in the tradition of those who've had this office before thee, but I'm still able to work, for which I'm grateful. Thanks to this marvelous choir and orchestra. I count them as dear friends, their officers and directors. Thanks to Donny Osmond, the Five Browns, to Mr. Domiciano and Igor and Vesna Gruppman, to Gladys Knight and Stanford Olsen, to John Longhurst and the International Choir and the missionaries. Thank you. Thank you so much, so very, very much, my good friend Mike Wallace, and your friend Mary, your wife Mary. To President Monson, President Faust, President Packer, and all who have expressed themselves this night, I thank you for your kind words. And to all of you, my friends and co-workers, wherever you may be across this broad world, thank you for your great kindness to me. Thank you for your good wishes. Thank you for your prayers. Let's have another such party 5 years from now. We'll put 100 candles on the cake and invite Mike to come back and see if he can make it. God bless you one and all, my dear, dear friends. I humbly pray in the name of him whom I try to serve, my Redeemer and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.